Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's coming up tonight. House Republicans are already talking about impeaching Hillary Clinton based on absolutely nothing. But it just shows that the Republicans have completely lost touch with reality. Donald Trump and Marco Rubio are already planning to dismantle environmental protections if they get elected, and both men are on the wrong side of climate change. And the corporate-controlled media is doing a fantastic job of promoting fake scandals. We'll tell you how phony controversies like Benghazi and Planned Parenthood are big business for the corporate media. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Republicans in the House of Representatives have clearly lost their minds. Of course, that statement actually implies that they were, at one point or another, considered sane, and I don't even know if that's a fair assessment. But either way, Republicans in the House are already talking about impeaching Hillary Clinton in 2016. Keep in mind that even though Clinton is currently the Democratic frontrunner, we have yet to have a single primary, let alone a general election. But I guess Republicans are confident enough that they're going to lose next year's elections, so they're already preparing to impeach Clinton. Leading the charge is Representative Mo Brooks from Alabama, who claims that Hillary's use of a private email server was a clear violation of federal law, making her subject to the high crimes and misdemeanors standard that impeachment requires. Now, legally speaking, Representative Brooks can file articles of impeachment at any point that he chooses against any sitting official, including the president. The House of Representatives does bring the articles of impeachment to a vote, and if they have merit, they go over to the Senate for trial. Now, Brooks says that he'll be filing that paperwork on Clinton's first day in office. Now, here's the problem. Hillary Clinton has not committed a crime. This whole made-up email scandal has not turned up any kind of information that would lead to an indictment or criminal charges, and there's almost no way that it could. You know, unless we find an email where Hillary Clinton was directly feeding crystal meth recipes to children, I think it's safe to say that Hillary has not broken any laws here. Do you remember what happened when Republicans impeached Bill Clinton? Yeah, sure, comedians had some fun with his testimony, but the public at large felt that the impeachment was a distraction from important issues, and Bill Clinton's approval rating skyrocketed after his impeachment, resulting in him leaving office as the third most popular president in U.S. history. More importantly, Republicans have clearly lost all notion of what high crimes and misdemeanors really are. On no fewer than 8 separate occasions, House Republicans have thrown out the idea of impeachment against President Obama, even though there haven't been any indications that the man has broken a single law. Some of the things that they wanted to impeach Obama for include Benghazi, his birth certificate, and for, in their own words, trying to push his agenda, which that is actually Republican code talk for trying to do his job. The scariest thought is that idiots like Mo Brooks think that it's perfectly acceptable to start tossing out the idea of impeachment, and this man is a sitting member of the U.S. House of Representatives. Brooks and his fellow conservatives in Washington have turned this entire democracy in America into a joke, and that's not forgivable. The only way to finish this horrible joke is to make sure that voter turnout in the 2016 election is higher than ever, so we can send the Tea Party and the few remaining establishment Republicans back home where they can't cause any more harm to our country. And speaking of damage being caused by Republicans, there are currently no candidates seeking the Republican nomination for president in the United States that hit the following 3 points. They believe climate change is real, they believe human activity is making it worse, and they believe we need to act. No candidates agree on all three of those points. Most of them don't even agree on one of them. To make matters worse, these reality-denying politicians are already laying out their plans on how they will scale back environmental protections if they ever make it to the White House. The current Republican frontrunner, Donald Trump, said in a recent interview that his budget cuts would focus on two important federal agencies, the Department of Education and the Environmental Protection Agency. According to Trump, what the EPA does is, quote, a disgrace, and that, quote, every week they come out with new regulations. When Trump was pressed about who would be in charge of protecting the environment after he destroys the EPA, he responded by saying that the environment would be just fine. What Trump is doing here is jumping on the same pro-business, anti-environment bandwagon that's become the staple of modern Republican talking points. There's no evidence whatsoever that supports his claim about regulations harming businesses, and in fact, study after study has confirmed that regulations actually create more jobs than they cost, and that they create an overall economic benefit to the economy as a whole. So Donald Trump is really saying that the profit margin of an individual business is more important than the health of the overall economy, and of course, it's more important than the health of the environment and U.S. citizens. But Trump isn't the only Republican presidential hopeful out there using outdated talking points to justify his attack on the EPA. Republican Senator Marco Rubio has also made it clear that the EPA will be dismantled under his watch. During his first major speech on his energy policy last week, Rubio told a crowd that if he gets elected, he would immediately do away with the EPA's Clean Power Plan, and that he would speed up the permitting process for new oil and gas drilling leases. He went on to say that he would cut 10 other unspecified agencies that he says are unfairly creating regulatory burdens for the energy industry. Overall, Rubio's policy reflects the pervasive Republican attitude towards the dirty energy industry, and that is, let them drill whenever and wherever they like, regardless of the consequences. Remarkably, Rubio has not been on the receiving end of too much cash from the dirty energy industry, with less than $700,000 given to his campaigns from the industry over the last few years. But considering the fact that he's only had two election campaigns for a national office so far, that is actually a pretty decent amount of money. And his pro-drilling stance is likely to net him even more from the industry as his presidential campaign continues to move forward. While Republicans have made attacking the EPA a centerpiece of their campaigns for years, they've made very little progress in actually dismantling the agency. The only area where they have had success is in opening up new areas for energy exploitation and in securing millions of dollars from the dirty energy industry for their campaigns, so these tired talking points are likely just a ploy to get campaign dollars. But that's not a chance that any of us need to be willing to take, considering the fact that the fate of our environment is on the line. But the EPA is not the only Trojan horse that Republicans have in their crosshairs right now. The war on Planned Parenthood is getting more intense by the day. Earlier this week, the state of Texas announced that they were officially ending the federal funding of Planned Parenthood by no longer granting Medicaid funds to the Women's Health Organization. And just to be clear, Medicaid provides health care coverage to low-income families. So this means that the state is not only taking a dig at women in general, but they're hitting low-income women exceptionally hard. And this is all based on a lie that the organization sells the body parts of fetuses to the highest bidder. The reality is that Planned Parenthood is allowed to provide the tissue for medical research, which they have done for many, many years. And the research being conducted with this tissue has helped develop new vaccines against deadly diseases, saving no fewer than 5,000 lives a year. And researchers suggest that almost every American alive today has benefited in some way from fetal tissue research. Republican presidential candidate Ben Carson has also conducted research using fetal tissue, but you don't hear Republicans talking about that. There are two reasons right now why Republicans are attacking Planned Parenthood. The first is because the party has a disgusting disdain towards women. There's no denying that fact. Planned Parenthood provides vital vital medical services to women all over the country, including mammograms, cancer screenings, and OBGYN services. 97% of the work done by the organization is for women's health services and has absolutely nothing to do with pregnancy termination. But the Republicans don't care about those facts. All they care about is keeping women in their place so that they can stay obedient and wait for a Republican man to tell them what they can and cannot do with their own bodies, and that includes receiving basic medical treatment. Now, the second reason we're still seeing this attack on Planned Parenthood is because it helps bring out the crazy fringe of the Republican Party at a time when Republicans are losing in every hypothetical presidential matchup versus a Democratic opponent. Not only that, but they need their religious anti-woman base to show up for the 2016 elections in huge numbers because they have to defend their majorities in both the House and Senate, and low voter turnout will hand both of these houses back over to the Democrats. So don't expect the Planned Parenthood issue to go away in the next 13 months, because if we've seen in the past, Republicans find a good talking point, even one that's based on a complete fantasy, they're never going to stop using it. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more.
Ring of Fire is always on. Radio, YouTube, social media, and news. The news stories that matter to progressives are always available at ringoffireradio.com, along with commentary, interviews, and so much more. ringoffireradio.com.
The corporate media is having a blast covering issues like Planned Parenthood hearings and Hillary Clinton's emails, but there's a problem. These are made-up scandals that only the most hardcore right-winger actually believes are true. But that hasn't stopped the corporate media from devoting countless hours to covering these issues because it's great for their ratings. And I have Eric Bollert, a senior fellow at Media Matters for America, with me now to tell us all about it. Eric, you and all the great folks over at Media Matters have done a phenomenal job for more than a decade now of just kind of keeping track of everything that the media not only is letting the Republicans get away with, but in a lot of times they're helping to make the problems worse. And one of the best examples is coming from us, from the media. Just in the last month, we've got Benghazi, we have Planned Parenthood, we have every possible manufactured fake scandal that Republicans could dream of, and the press is right there helping them along, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting with Benghazi. I mean, the walls really are falling in on poor Trey Gowdy. You know, he's going to get his long-sought-after testimony from Hillary Clinton this week, and my hunch is after the debate last Thursday night, he was trying to figure out how they could cancel her testimony. And so what we've had with the Benghazi committee, I mean, we've had two Republican congressmen go on record with a media interview saying that, yes, the Benghazi committee was created to essentially sabotage Hillary's political life and try to drive down her polling numbers. We've got someone on staff, lifetime Republican investigator, military guy. He said he was fired because he wasn't properly obsessed with chasing Hillary Clinton's emails. He actually wanted to investigate what happened in Libya, what happened in Benghazi with the terror attack. So the walls are crumbling down, but you have to remember, I mean, this Benghazi charade has been going on for 3 years, and the press has been enabling it for 3 years. And I include this sort of email charade story. You know, the email story is sort of a process story in search of a crime, and it's been 8 or 9 months of that. So the press has been, you know, typing up Trey Gowdy's press releases. They've been sort of breathlessly regurgitating every one of his leaks for these phony stories. And now the whole thing's imploding, and even the press, even the DC press, especially in the last week, is, I mean, Maureen Dowd in the New York Times, who's sort of a professional Hillary Clinton hater, wrote a column about, you know, how the committee's time was up. But the press really needs to look at its role in Benghazi in the email charade. They can't just say, "Oh, Trey Gowdy blew it." They're the third wheel in all of this.
You know, I think it's funny how we have social media, even Huffington Post to an extent, they take a lot of heat for making these kind of clickbait titles on stories. Right. But when you look at what Benghazi really is, even in print media, that's nothing more than clickbait for these Republican hardcore, like, oh, I've got to know the latest of what we've found. And one thing the press has never done, they've never even said what exactly Republicans are wanting to find, you know, in these Benghazi hearings or in the emails. I mean, what are they looking for? What do they think is going to be found? I mean, was Hillary Clinton selling, you know, drugs through these private email servers? What do they want out of all this?
Right. Here's the bizarre part, right? This is the eighth investigation, right? This is the eighth investigation into the Benghazi attack. You know, Mike Rogers, senior Republican member of the House, he headed up one of the previous seven. You know, typically when the opposition party, you know, has an investigation, has an inquiry, comes out with a final report, and the final report says, oh, the White House did nothing wrong. There was no cover up. There was no malpractice. There was no stand down order. In a normal world, that kind of ends it, right? And that was 18 months ago. And the Republicans said, let's do it again. Let's have a select committee and let's just keep looking. And, you know, I just did a piece that's up on Media Matters this week about, you know, looking back in terms of context. You know, 9/11, there was one bipartisan congressional inquiry, and then there was the 9/11 Commission, which the Bush White House fought did not want to be created and then stonewalled it for years. And if you go back further, you know, when Ronald Reagan was president, he essentially had four Benghazis in 18 months with terror attacks on American outposts in Beirut. Over 300 Americans were killed there. There was one bipartisan investigation and it took 2 months and that was it. So you really have to put this Benghazi stuff into perspective. We have gone so far over the edge in terms of just nonstop Republican scandal, and frankly, the press kind of cheering it along. They love the scandal infrastructure. You have to kind of take a step back to say, we are in such uncharted waters. All of this is completely unprecedented. Again, 9/11, one commission, Benghazi, eight commissions. It doesn't add up at all.
Well, you know, those facts, those are the kind of facts that the media could have come out with a very long time ago. They could have, you know, countered with the fact that under George W. Bush's watch, we had at least a dozen embassy attacks where U.S. citizens died. But they didn't. They feed the beast because it feeds their ratings. It's not necessarily, in some cases, that they're taking a side one way or the other. It's that they want to keep the story alive because it sells newspapers, it sells advertisements, it feeds the corporate beast, and that's exactly what the media has become.
Yeah, I think it does that, but I think there's a partisan edge as well. I mean, because the Democrats could have done this under George Bush. You know, they could have done whatever they wanted. I mean, it was such a massive national security failure. But my recollection from the press was, oh, you know, let's not do that. You know, that's not what America needs right now. We need to, and not just, you know, in the weeks after 9/11, but in the years after 9/11. Oh, you know, you really shouldn't question President Bush's patriotism. You know, he did his best. You know, to me, there's sort of this, there's far more respect, I think, for a Republican president by the press. Whereas, you know, we had Obama. And whether Obama was the target of Benghazi or Hillary Clinton, the press is just like, this is like fantastic. Let's have more hearings. Because they love the scandal pursuit when the Democrats in the White House, I think. We just didn't see that excitement or that pursuit, you know, when Bush was in the White House. So I think there's a different standard. And I think you're right in terms of, hey, let's cover a fake scandal instead of covering Medicare or Social Security or things that are, you know, public policy issues.
Well, you know, we can take this all the way back to the late 90s when the press was trying to, you know, drum up this whole Monica Lewinsky thing and then trumping the impeachment talks. And you would think that both the press and the Republican Party would have learned a lesson. They were actively trying to take down Bill Clinton. Yeah, they got him impeached, and his approval rating, because the public got so tired of hearing it, went to an all-time high. I mean, the man left office as the third most popular president in U.S. history because of the constant, like, scandal. Now they're trying to do this with another Clinton. Do you think in the end this could actually help Hillary if they don't, you know, shut up about Benghazi. I mean, they could be helping her.
Oh, I think it already has. I think Kevin McCarthy, when he went on Fox News 2.5 weeks ago, whatever it was, and he bragged about the Benghazi Select Committee was created to take down her career. I think you can already look at it. I think months from years from now, people will look back and say that was the turning point in Hillary Clinton's campaign. I mean, that gave her momentum going into the debate. Bernie Sanders said enough of these damn emails, which gave her more momentum. Her poll numbers are kind of astounding in the last week or so. Who knows how long that will last? But there's no doubt. Look, the Clintons have been cursed with obsessive pursuers, and they have been blessed with obsessive pursuers, usually the same people. I wrote a piece last week, you know, suggesting, you know, Trey Gowdy is the new Ken Starr. These people, they can't stop, right? They're given millions and millions to investigate, and they feel a pressure to come up with something. Ken Starr spent 4 years on Whitewater, had nothing, tens of millions of dollars. He decided, well, I'll investigate Bill Clinton's sex life. And so Trey Gowdy, I think, is in the same boat, $4.5 million for 3 hearings. This is, we've never seen money spent like that to produce so little. And so he's trying to stitch together some kind of conspiracy. And again, you know, the walls are coming down. And there's no question that this has helped Hillary Clinton. She likes to be in a fight, and it reminds Democrats of why they hate Republicans.
Yeah. Well, you know, it is great. And again, the corporate-controlled media, they could have shut this thing down a long time ago, but it's money in the bank for them. And unfortunately, that is all that the media today cares about. And I don't see that problem getting any better. The best solution we have is, you know, groups like Media Matters, who do a wonderful job, and independent media outlets that are not dependent on corporate shareholders. Eric Bollert, thank you very much for talking with us today.
My pleasure. I'll talk to you soon.
So, Farron, we're still in the wake of the Democratic debate, amongst other things that's happening in the Democratic Party, and we've discussed those. But I want to touch on Bernie Sanders coming out of the debate. You know, the polls, despite what I guess the message that Joe Biden may or may not have gotten. The polls clearly showed that the debate was a win for both Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton, and basically a loss for Joe Biden. Now, one of the things that I thought was really astute by Bernie Sanders when he came out of the debate earlier this week, he announced that he's going to be giving a big speech on what is democratic socialism. And coming out of that debate, it occurred to me that there were basically two things that Bernie Sanders had to address. One is the knee-jerk reaction by Americans to the words democratic socialism. I don't think he did a good enough job in explaining what that is. And it's not terribly complicated. People want to know what a democratic socialist is. A democratic socialist is the person who came up with the idea of Social Security. Democratic socialist is the person who supports Medicare. Democratic socialist is the guy who came up with the idea of a free public school education. Democratic socialists are the people who brought you a free higher education 30, 40 years ago in various states around the country, and so on. It's fairly straightforward. It's not as mysterious or exotic, I think, as some Americans make it out to be. And also, a democratic socialist is someone who wants to strengthen and expand Social Security. He came out with that plan this week, very specifics on how he intends to raise the cap, use that cap as a means in which to change the way cost of living is calculated for elderly people. We know for a long time the Department of Labor has done some, has run sort of basically experimental inflation measures for elderly people that take into account things like drug costs and medical costs, which tend to increase at a higher rate than inflation. Because frankly, let's face it, if you're a senior, your costs are not the same as if you're someone who is in their 40s or their 20s or their 50s. And so you got Bernie Sanders out there pushing that, this idea of explaining to the American public what a socialist is. And there's also the other thing that he's got to do, I think, in the next debate is to begin to talk about his record of getting things done. You know, Farron, as well as anybody, that Bernie Sanders has been involved in actual legislation and reform as a legislature. And despite the fact that it's very hard for independents, supposedly, to get stuff passed, he has figured out both in the House and as a senator how to do that very thing.
He has. And, you know, just to take it back one second, you know, you explained the democratic socialism, all of the great plans that have been put forward by democratic socialists. The problem, the reason socialism, that word itself, has such a negative connotation with the American public is the fact that we have a right-wing media out there that unfortunately is, you know, they have higher ratings than any other media outlet, unfortunately. But they get out there and they equate socialism to fascism. They equate socialism to Nazism or to communism. And people eat it up. These Republicans eat it up. They spread the word on Facebook and Twitter, and they share short videos of this. And it's an absolute lie, but this right-wing media machine keeps pumping it out there, and that's why it's still alive. If you
well,
didn't
we should
have
be clear. We should be clear, too, that if you poll the words socialism and capitalism, the answers you get back in terms of approval of those words for people under the age of 30 or 35 is radically different than what you get for people over the age of 45. Under the age of 30 in this country, the word socialism actually polls better than the word capitalism. So it may be the case that Fox News continues to associate, I don't know, all sorts of horrible happenings with the words democratic socialist. But the reality is that it's really only edifying maybe positions that older people are predisposed to because they grew up during the Cold War. And, you know, everything that was even remotely associated with the Soviet Union is considered, I don't know, verboten. But the fact of the matter is that he has passed amendments on child labor, increasing funding for people living in low income and living in poverty for heating, fighting corporate welfare bills in the Senate. He was involved in greening the U.S. government and in amendments to protect our troops, restricting the bailout to protect U.S. workers in 2009, helping veterans, kids. The thing is, Bernie Sanders has a long history of legislating, of actually working with people across the aisle. And this is something that I think that he's got to go out there and promote in the future.
And that's all the time we have for tonight, but you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com. And you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.